Hachette Audio presents Girls of Storm and Shadow, written by Natasha Ngan, read by Allison Hiroto. To James. Two Jimmies made this book happen. You are one of them. Love, always. Please be aware that this book contains scenes of violence and self-harm, and references to sexual abuse and trauma recovery. Casts. At night, the heavenly rulers dreamed of colors, and into the day those colors bled onto the earth, raining down onto the paper people and blessing them with the gifts of the gods. But in their fear, some of the paper people hid from the rain, and so were left untouched. And some basked in the storm, and so were blessed above all others with the strength and wisdom of the heavens. The Ikaran May Scripts. Paper cast. Fully human, unadorned with any animal demon features, and incapable of demon abilities such as flight. Steel cast. Humans endowed with partial animal demon qualities, both in physicality and abilities. Mooncast, fully demon, with whole animal demon features, such as horns, wings, or fur on a humanoid form, and complete demon capabilities. The Demon King's Post-War Treaty on the Castes. Deep in the dark heart of the royal palace, the king was hiding. He'd been there for weeks, eschewing all visitors, save for the shamans who worked on his injuries, and his two closest confidants to nurse wounds, both of the body and the ego. He would never have admitted this was what he was doing, of course. And if anyone were to dare even suggest he was struggling, he'd swiftly have them executed. None of it was painful. None of it was too much for the great demon king of Ikara to handle. Yet like most lies people tell themselves, it came apart in the shadow and quiet of the night. The king, however much he expressed otherwise, was shaken. His wounds had penetrated deeper than flesh and bone. They had burrowed, insidiously, down each vein and cell and pore, until he could feel the fear echoing alongside every beat of his heart. And this fear took a shape, a name. Lei G. He refused to speak it out loud, but his body betrayed him. It whispered her name to him in the rhythm of his pulse, showed him her face when he was asleep, blood-splattered porcelain skin, furled lips, wild eyes, those bright golden eyes honed with so much rage it pierced right to his soul, right down to places within him he thought he'd long since stamped out of life. When it got too much, when her name and face would mock him so that he felt he couldn't breathe and all the walls of his rooms were closing in, the king called for a girl. None of those girls, of course. Those girls he had yet to properly deal with. Though he would. But another girl, a pretty steel-cast lynx form from the night houses, with softly furred hips, perhaps. Or a young paper slave, fresh from a raid. He didn't care. They would bring him a girl, and he would ruin her, just to prove he could. To feel once again that he was all-powerful. One human girl would not get the better of him, even if the constant sting and ache of his scars reminded him how close she had come. Each day, royal shamans came to heal the injuries to the king's throat and face. Naja had done well. The shamans had arrived just in time after the girl's attack to save much of his vocal cords, though it hurt to speak and his voice was hoarser than before. Rough, a guttural grunt. His right eye, however, was beyond repair. The socket had been a mess of severed nerves and pulpy flesh, too damaged even to fit a glass eye. In the weeks since the attack, It had grown a little less horrifying under the magic of the shamans. While it would be many months more until the rest of his face was back to normal, even shamans couldn't bring back life from the dead. And his missing right eye would forever be a reminder of that night. The king recalled one of his generals, also a bull form, who'd once come to him about using the royal shamans to remove an ugly slash across half his face.
"Battle scars are a badge of honor, General Yu," he told the soldier. "They are marks of power. To rid oneself of them would be to show weakness. Wear your scars with pride."
Wear your scars with pride. What god's damn crap. He always knew it, of course, but some part of him had believed in the sentiment once. Not anymore. The king knew now exactly what scars were. Reminders of your own failings. And so were those who dealt them. The girl was still out there, but the king had faith. Nadja had not failed him yet. She would find her, just as she promised she would, along with the traitor, Katai Hano's daughter, and she would bring both of them back to the palace for him. Because this was something else the king had learned about scars. They were a brilliant furnace of hate. And if rage like this could give a weak human girl the power to attack him, well, they would see what it could do to a demon king with a ferocious hunger for revenge. 1. From the night we escape the palace, what was at first a light scattering of flakes grows into a snowstorm. It takes less than 24 hours for the first layer to settle. Just over a day until it builds into a thick blanket of glittering white. One more day, and the snow has covered everything, a carpet of muffling powder that stings your eyes in the daylight and casts strange shapes at night from the shadows. After 2 weeks, it's as though we've lived in this frosted world forever. I trudge through the deep drifts beyond the temple, my boots breaking the snowpack with heavy crunches. The cold has numbed my entire body. I flex my stiff fingertips in my gloves. Melting shucks of ice keep sluicing over the tops of my borrowed leather boots, no matter how tightly I lace them. But at least my hands and feet have some sort of protection from the weather. My face battles directly with the elements, and this is a war it is losing. Wind stings my exposed cheeks as I peer through the dancing flakes, trying to see where the leopard demons have gone. We've been trekking through the mountains for almost an hour now. The steep forested hills are packed with snow, each leaf-stripped tree encased in ice. The afternoon is eerily silent, just rustling snow crystals and boot crunch and my own heavy breathing.
"How you doing back there, little princess?"
I sigh. Not quite so silent. "My name," I shout back, "as I've told you a million times, Bo, is Lei." No sooner are the words out of my mouth than they are whipped away by the wind. Ice flakes dance around my nose, land cold, wet kisses on my raw cheeks.
"Princess?"
Bo's voice sounds again, this time clearer. The siblings must be just a few yards ahead. My breath billows around me as I hurry to catch up. Their tall forms materialize through the snow-blurred wind, as long-limbed and willowy as the trunks of the trees around them, and almost human in appearance. As I get closer, their demon details reveal themselves. Snubbed leopard ears, athletic haunches, long tails flicking from side to side, sheathed in the same beige-black spotted fur that covers the rest of their bodies. Green eyes glint from dark-rimmed lids. Their round faces are so similar it's hard to tell them apart at a glance. One of the two sets of eyes is soft and kind. Nita. The other pair, her brother Bose, dances with amusement. Nita rushes to me with a relieved cry, brushing the wet straggles of hair back from my brow.
"Thanks, Samsi. We were scared for a moment we'd lost you.
Sorry, Lei, we're moving too fast. We were trying to go slowly, but...
Any slower and we'd be traveling back in time, Bo quips. You papers,
he adds with an impatient cluck, scratching the underside of his chin as he regards me down the length of his flat feline nose. Nita shoots him a frown.
Bo?
What? Anybody born without built-in weather protection is missing out, I say.
Maybe we should turn back. Snowflakes dust Nita's spotted fur, and she brushes a hand over her brow absentmindedly, looking worried.
We haven't found anything yet, and Lei looks half frozen to death.
Marin was right. This was a bad idea. Bo rests a hand on his bony hip.
You're going to trust feathers now? Come on, sis. What does that bird brain know?
You'll defy Marin's orders just to annoy him, Nita retorts.
Why else do you think I agreed to let Lei come along on our little hunting trip?
The leopard boy grins.
No offense, little one, he tells me, but it wasn't exactly for your expert tracking skills.
A lot of good your tracking skills are doing us, I point out.
Found anything yet, hmm?
While Bo cocks his head in amusement, I straighten, squaring my shoulders. I'm still barely half the height of the leopard siblings, but it makes me feel stronger all the same. I asked you to let me come today because I'm sick of hiding away in that temple. It's been more than 2 weeks now. If I have to spend another day listening to Hiro's endless chanting and the rest of you sparring or talking war tactics while refusing to let me do anything, my brain will burst. I reshuffle my scarf, bunch my gloved hands into fists. Now, can we please go catch something good to eat? I'm sick of roasted taro for every meal. Nita hesitates, but Bo tosses up his hands.
You know what? Princess is right. If I have to eat one more piece of taro, I'm going to become a taro.
With a dramatic huff, he throws himself onto his back. Snowflakes rain down around him.
Look,
he croaks in mock horror, blinking up at us from a distinctly bow-shaped hole in the snow.
It's already starting. I am one with the taro, and it feels terrible.
He flounces back up, coat covered in ice, and beams his wide, snaggle-toothed smile.
Get it? Terrible?
Oh, little bro, Nita sighs. Your jokes are just so taro-ific. All three of us laugh at this, the sound breaking the eerie quiet of the snow-draped forest, until a loud crack to our left cuts us off. We whip around, my heart lurching into my throat, only to see a pack of snow that had been balanced on a banyan's branches crash to the floor with a heavy flump. Nita and Bo straighten from the defensive stances they'd instinctively adopted. Bo snorts, releasing hold of the knife at his belt.
Scared of snow, big sis? Afraid it'll turn your pretty hair wet and scraggly?
Nita's eyes slice his way. Don't think I didn't see your reaction. But there's a touch of something cautious as she turns around, lifting her nose to test the air. Her ears twitch, listening. Then she starts forward.
Come on, she says. Something's definitely out there. And Lei, stay close this time.
We continue into the swirling white. It's all I can do to keep up with the siblings, their lithe, moon-cast bodies slinking easily between columns of ice-wreathed trees. While Nita and Bo carve the layers of snow cleanly with each neat lift of their lean leopard haunches, I slog clumsily through the thick drifts. The snowpack is as deep as my knees. Hidden tree roots tangle with my boots. Every drag of frigid air cuts my throat. But despite the chill, sweat beads inside my coat and under the fur scarf wrapped around my neck. The demons don't let up their pace. We stop only to take swigs of the water flask at Nita's waist or to check for signs of the animal she and Bo are tracking, the siblings dipping their heads together to discuss its markings in low voices.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.